Hi everybody, my name is Norbert and I'm one of the sysadmins at Signet. And let me start why I thought about self-hosting a password manager. I don't know if you guys remember a couple of months back, we had a breach at LastPass. And you know, LastPass was one of the companies that we trusted, whoever had an account there, that to keep our data safe, but they didn't. So I thought maybe self-hosting manager application might be a good, you know, good thing to do. But anyways, let me start at the beginning. For some people that don't know and that don't use password managers, what are password managers? Well, password managers is essentially a application that helps you store secure information. So that could be passwords, that could be secure notes, important pictures, credit card information, passport information, anything that you can, that you want to maybe keep safe. Also, you know, the password manager has a feature of keeping the data secure in the vault. It's usually encrypted, and some password manager, you can actually set your encryption to whatever you choose. So you can go as complex as you want. Now, also some password manager applications will allow you to share your password with your family or your coworkers. Some of them have a really cool feature, which is called emergency access. Let's say something happens to you, but your password managers need to be accessed by a family member. You can set that up. So that's one of the features of the password managers. Now, the benefits of having a password manager is one password. So you can remember just one. You don't have to, you know, remember multiple passwords. Time saving. So when you're on the website, the password manager will fill the login credentials for you. Now, there's also a benefit that if you are using password manager to fill out your credentials on the website. So let's say you go to a website that looks the same as what you're expecting, but the password manager didn't fill your information. And that means that could be a phishing website or something like that. So it could be a benefit to, you know, help you save putting your password in an unsecured website. If you host your own password manager, you don't have to worry about other people accessing your vault, like an example of LastPass, for example, right? Obviously, if you keep your password safe, there'll be, you know, you don't have to worry about, you know, somebody brute forcing your password. Now, the other benefits of password managers, they will create a strong and secure passwords for you. So that's part of some of the benefits that we have. Now, why you should use a password manager? I don't know. So let me start here. So this is a website that has a big database of all the passwords that has been lost by the company. So the companies has been affected by a bad actor. I was able to gain some information. So if you haven't gone to the website, I would highly encourage you to go and see. And see what email you enter your email account or and see how many companies lost access or lost the data to your, like, for example, credentials, your email addresses and all the stuff. So this is a really neat website that I go every once in a while just to see where my password has been exposed. And so if it has been exposed, I highly encourage people to change the password on those websites that you see there as soon as possible and to use a unique password for that. That website also offers a password checker, sort of. So if you have your favorite password and you want to enter it, you can actually see if that password is available for anybody to use. The nefarious actor is able to brute force your account or brute force any account with that particular password that you're using. So maybe if that password shows up in this database, maybe it's not a good password to use. And this is another example of, if you like, this is just a hit GitHub repo that has a variety of passwords that you can use for brute forcing. But also if you want to go and check check it out and see what kind of passwords are people are using and how it can be used for, you know, bad reasons or so. Yeah, that's just a repo with a lot of that information. All right, now, another reason that we want to use Password Manager and use unique passwords on every website is because companies do get hacked. And companies, you know, it's not necessarily their fault, but somebody clicks a bad link and then they let a bad actor in and then they lose control of the data. I found this website is it's part of the University of State of California. And then this website actually shows you companies that actually have to say that they had been breached, that they lost data. So you can actually search this website and see if a company that you use and you have an account with, maybe they're disclosed that they lost that they had a breach and your password or your personal information or any other information might have been exposed. There is a Canadian version. Unfortunately, there is no Canadian version that I was able to find. It's a government one, but I found a gentleman that has a Canadian version of it. So you can see that there was breaches disclosed on May 17th, April 25th of, you know, all the companies that lost access to to your data, and now it's on the dark web, and it's, you know, it's being used to either phish or used for brute force attacks, or, you know, like get into your account for whatever reason, right? Now let's talk about, well, we're here for self-hosting, right? So what are the benefits of self-hosting? Self-hosting's that you will have the control of your data. So essentially you can keep your data safe and you are in control. Nobody else has access to it. Like if you choose to host it in the cloud, like AWS or Oracle or Google Cloud Services or any, or Azure or Microsoft Azure, you have control of the operating system. You will be able to make sure the environment is safe, make sure you have proper firewalls, essentially be a system administrator for it. You can also minimize breach because you can tell, you can set up software that will alert you if somebody's trying to attack your system, or you can use you have more control over your data. And then flexibility, for example, if you do host a password manager application, you have certain features that you may not have access to if you don't pay for a service. Maybe just you're using a free service that is out there and you have to pay X amount of money to get additional services. So with self-hosting, you may be able to have access to those features. And then obviously the most important one for me is gain knowledge, learn how to set up and deploy a password manager safely, securely, and use backups. Make sure that you have backups that you're able to use in case something happens, right? So it's just flexibility, gives you a lot of flexibility if you do host. Now, there are some drawbacks, of course, to having, being able to host your password manager. So one of them is that you will be the system administrator of that system. You will be responsible for backups. You will be responsible for implementation and, maintaining your environment. There will be some costs to hardware. Like, for example, if you go to Google or Azure or AWS, you will have to pay most likely for an instance that you can run your password manager. Also, you need a domain name. There's costs there. You have to be able to monitor your system to make sure that nothing nefarious is happening. And then also you will need an email service, because for password managers, you want it to send you an email if somebody, or some kind of a monitoring system that that helps you monitor that system. So that's one of the challenges. Now, other drawbacks is you're going to have to trust AWS. You're going to have to you know, make sure that your password, your administrator password, is nice and secure, that you have, you know, you are essentially responsible for your own data. So you're not moving the buck to somebody else. You have to take responsibility of that. So that, I think, is one of the drawbacks, because, you know, with our busy lives, it does take time. It does take a little bit of time. Also, there's a learning curve that if you do want to deploy one of the password managers, there's some learning curves. I'm going to show a couple very beginner-friendly password manager options, I think, in the next slide. Okay, so now let's begin with the option. Now, the first option I'm going to show you is the very old password manager. It's called KeePass. It's been around for a very long time. This is actually the first password manager I ever used. I personally like it because the reason I like it is because I know where my vault is at all times. What I mean by vault is the file that keeps all my information secure. So keeps it local, you know, but then this KeePass doesn't have easy way to synchronize your vault across multiple platforms. Like, for example, you have a laptop, you have a phone, you want to be able to synchronize. There is a way, but it's not easy. Now, I know some of you probably says, oh, KeePass, that rings a bell. Yes, because in the last week, there was a disclosure made that you are able to get your master password for this application. Now, my take on that is that, to be honest, this is not a very something that you should be worried if you are using KeePass. And the reason I say that is that because this can be only exploited locally. And the reason I say that I don't think that is very crucial, because if you have malware in your laptop, then you have bigger problems than losing your master password of your password manager. So that's why I don't think this exploit is very, very high, right? I think it's medium at best, because it's an exploit that you can access, you can exploit locally. So like I said, if you are using KeePass and you are using it locally, and hopefully your computer is not infected, then you have nothing to worry about. And to be honest, this will be fixed in about a month, maybe less. But again, if you like this, if you use it, it's great. If you want to try it, like I said, this is one of the password managers that I started with. Now, this is a better option for the same thing. So KeePassXL is a fork of KeePass, and this is actually better. So my recommendation would be, if you're going to try something, try this. Try, play around with this, see if you like it. This is a feature-rich application. It has MFA, it has other things. It's just a better application in my opinion. So if you want to take control of your password and you want to keep them local, you can. But this application has also ability for you to sync with other services. Like, for example, with KeePassXL, you can sync to sync.com, Dropbox, Google Drive, or any other storage provider that you have. Now, what you are actually syncing is your vault. So now, if you keep your password nice and long and secure, then you can put that file on any of those services, and you should be fairly safe, because this the application is encrypted. Even if somebody would get a hold of it without your password, it would be very hard, in my opinion, to brute force, unless you have a weak master password. With, just to touch on this application, it looks better. It's more of a it looks more current than, for example, this application. This is, like I said, this application has been around for a long time. It hasn't changed much in that much. But anyways, I still like it. I still like both of the options to use. I actually personally use one of those options, and I use them with one of my cloud services providers as a sync, so I can have access to my passwords on the phone and also on the computer or whatever desktop I'm on. Now, my next two examples will be something that is self-hosted. And I tried this on Oracle free tier. Oracle actually has a really good Oracle Cloud has a really good free tier just to play around with, and if you want to just start and dip your toe into self-hosting and you want to do it for free, Oracle has a really good free tier. They offer a VM that is 4 processors, 24 gigs of memory, and I believe it has 100 or 200 gigs of block storage, which is it's a perfect playground for you. And you sign up for it, they give you a free month for free to their paid services. And then after that, you have to be on the free tier. But in my opinion, the free tier is perfect enough for you to play with. So the two implementations I'm going to share with you today, it was tested on Oracle Cloud because that's the only cloud service that I didn't have an account with before. And I was able to get a free service for about a month so I could play around with the two implementations. Also on this page, I have a link to a GitHub repo that is providing you a free tier, sort of like a breakdown. It will give you a list of providers that offer free services for you. It's like it has like Google, it has Amazon, it has all the other stuff. But the reason I picked Oracle was because they had the best one and it suited my needs for what I wanted to play with. All right, so the first example I want to give is Vaultwarden. And I do have a file for you guys. So if you go to my GitHub there on the link, you can actually access Bitwarden. And here it is. So this is the GitHub page. And what I tried to do is I tried to make it as easy to implement as I possibly could. So if you clone this repo to, you know, let's say you use Oracle Cloud Services, just as an example. I'm not recommending them or anything, but like I said, they're good free service that you can goof around with. You can install Linux on it. It is required for you to have Docker installed. So the way I wrote it was in a Docker compose file. So essentially I wrote the file that if you just implement it, it will spin up all necessary containers. In this instance, this is just a starting point. This I'm using Kendi. So there's two things that we have here. We have obviously Vaultwarden, which is a fork of a popular open source password manager called Bitwarden, but this Vaultwarden is written in Rust. So it's a very light application. So if you don't have a lot of resources, for example, it will run on pretty much anything. And for like a couple users to use, it's perfect. So I like it just for that reason. It's nice and light and easy to deploy. So Vaultwarden, I actually implemented it with Kendi proxy manager. And the reason I did that was because I wanted to have SSL. So I'm using Let's Encrypt in this example for my SSL cert, which is a free service that you can use to provide encryption for your domain. So as you can see, this is just a Docker compose file. The only thing that you would have to change is this file, which is the env file. Everything that you have to add is in this file. So if you just update your email address, update your domain. If you are using, so this in this example here, for example, I am using Google to send emails, but you can use any other email provider that you have. It's just Google. I have a throwaway Google email account that I use for monitoring and stuff like that. So I just use that. You enter email address, passwords. Now, for if you're going to use Google or Microsoft, Microsoft Outlook or Hotmail accounts, you do need to create an app password so you can actually use it. So once you do that and update, you obviously do your domain, your token. So this token is admin token is a token that you can access the administrator panel with. So by default, I made it that it is the signups are not available. So you have to send an invite to your email for the sign up to so you can actually use this. So you can sign up for an account for your account. And pretty much it. That's all it is. And then to create your password, your administrative password, this is the command that you use. Obviously, you would change my secure password to something very secure so you can manage this account. Another recommendation I would make is that if once you set up all your users and you don't want to leave your administrator password exposed, you can actually disable it. One second, disable it in the environment, in your ENV file, and you can say admin. You can actually remove this or comment out this whole line. And once you do that, the admin panel will not be accessible, which means that you will reduce your footprint for attacks. Now. So this is one password manager. Like I said, I like Vaultwarden because it's very light and it's not that difficult to set up. This example is actually taken from the Bitwarden wiki page. So, and the only thing I had to do is I had to add a bunch of variables for hosting and stuff like that. So those normally don't come with. So I just added that. I also added logs for you, to get logs and stuff like that. But anyways, yes, so that's my first example. Once you get that file, you literally, all you have to do is just edit the environment file, create your administrative password, and then Docker Compose app. And this will bring up the both containers for you. And then you'll be able to play around with this application. Now, my next example is, Passbolt. This is another open source and free application. With Passbolt, I believe you can actually have a pay service, but they offer a free and open application. So let me just see, there you go. So I made the same thing here. I created a repo that all you have to do is just update the ENV file and in this case, I chose to go with Traffic as my proxy manager. And the reason I chose that is because I just wanted to show that you can use any proxy manager that you want. The most popular ones are Traffic or Nginx proxy or just Nginx. You can use that as a proxy as well. The reason I picked Traffic was because I used Passbolt Hopes Help Center, and they have a really nice documentations to implement this. Now, let me just see. So as you can see, so this one is a little bit more complicated, has a little bit more, it's a little bit more involved. But it's the same principle. Once you update the ENV file, you'll be able to spin up this password manager on your instance. There's another thing that you have to update is in Traffic YAML file to get the password to get the let's encrypt password to license certificate. Sorry, certificate, you have to add that. As you can see, I left my email address here, which I'm going to remove after the meeting. But you just put in your email address in here, and then this will generate your password, and then let's encrypt certificate for your email, for your password manager. And then again, in the environment, so if you go to template for the environment, template is a little bit less, but basically it's the same thing. You have to enter all the information here. Once you do that, you can just spin up the container. And after you do the container, you can issue this command. This will create a password administrator account for you. And again, by default, I did disable the automatic sign up. So you do have to invite people to use your password manager. But the reason I did that is I don't want people to brute force those instances. But anyways, this is both of those files are just a starting point of your journey if you choose to self-host. And the reason I picked those two applications is because they're fairly popular, but they have different features. Like Passbolt is very good for sharing your accounts. Like let's say you want to share your email account, email passwords with your family. They're perfect for that. They will, it's easier to share. They have different features. So it depends which features you're looking for in your password manager. You can actually choose both. You can try both and then pick the one that works best for you. Yeah, and then that's about it. So that's it. I want to mention that they do have a really good help page, Passbolt. And the example that I just showed was essentially it is just a taking from their documents. The documents sometimes are hard to read. So what I did was I essentially combined everything in one file, so it's for ease of implementation. Now I want to mention Bitwarden because I like Bitwarden. They are free and open source application. I'm not showing an implementation here is because if you go to the link for on-prem services, they do have a really file that you just run once, and then it deploys, I believe, 6 or 7 containers, and will bring up the you follow a little wizard, and it will deploy your container. Now, Bitwarden is a little bit more resource intensive. So if you are going to use it in a cloud environment, you need a little bit more resources for that. But anyways, Bitwarden is also a good choice for that. It's very easy to implement. Like I said, if you go on our webpage, it will walk you through it, and it's very straightforward to implement. Now, let's say you don't want to host in the cloud. You don't trust Google, you don't trust any other services, but you like to host the password manager at your home. Well, there is an option, and the option is Cloudflare tunnels. Now, I didn't set up a demo for this one because unfortunately this is it's very complex. It just to do this demo, we would need another hour just to do that. I'm just going to run it have a simple example of how to implement. A lot of our ISPs that we use at home, they block any hosting that we can do. Cloudflare actually enables that. And the way they do that is they use something called a tunnel. And in simplest terms is that you set up your account on Cloudflare, you go to and set up your Cloudflare tunnel implementation. And then in my instance, I'm just using Docker. So for example, you download a Docker to a system or a laptop that you have at home that you want to host your password manager. And the way you do it is you download that Docker container from Cloudflare and create a network. And then part of that network at, for example, Bitwarden. So Cloudflare container and Bitwarden are on the same network, so which means that they can talk to each other. Now, part of your setup on Cloudflare is that you have to specify where you want to talk to. So for example, I'm a user here and I say, okay, I want to talk to Bitwarden at X domain name, right? It goes to Cloudflare. Cloudflare has a connection to its Docker container, which is a tunnel between you, your hosting machine inside your network to Cloudflare. And then says, oh, okay, I know this. It's on my network. So then goes to Bitwarden. And then you have access. You can fully host with SSL certificates because Cloudflare will take care of SSL certificates for you. So essentially, you can host any application internally with Cloudflare tunnels. Now, there's a drawback here. Because Cloudflare, this service is a proxy, and it's a layer 7 proxy, I believe, which means that Cloudflare can see any traffic that goes from their services to you. Now, Cloudflare is a big enough company, I don't think they will snoop on your traffic, but that is a possibility. So just make sure that you are aware of it, that if you are using Cloudflare tunnels, all the traffic going between you and your internal server will be going through their services, because they also provide a IDS for you. So, for example, they provide they will help you defend your instance, for example. So that, you know, like if somebody was trying to attack you from brute forcing and all the stuff. So this service will also provide that. Cloudflare also provides you ability to put some kind of email, you know, two-step verification or email, something that before you connect to your internal network, you have to verify with that. So they provide extra barrier. But again, there's a cost for that. The cost is that you do have to trust Cloudflare not to snoop on your information. That's pretty much it. Like I said, the implementation, it's a really good idea, it really works, but you do have to trust Cloudflare to be able to you know, securely to be able to host your application. I mean, to be honest, I mean, I did host some stuff with them. The implementation took about an hour to deploy through them. You know, overall, it was okay. Like I said, it's another option for self-hosting if you don't want to do it. Now, we're coming almost to the end. there's also some paid services that you can do. If you think that hosting your own password manager is too difficult or too time-consuming, there are tons of password managers that you can do. I mean, I'm only giving you a little sample. The reason I do that is because I used most of them. One password is pretty good. Dashlane, I also like. Bitwarden, obviously, I used. And then RoboForm, I also used. Now, RoboForm is one of the oldest password managers, I think, around. They're good, but like I said, some of them, Bitwarden does have a free tier, and then so was RoboForm. They also have a free tier. I don't think 1Password or Dashlane do have a free tier. At least I don't remember if they were. But if you think that having a, you know, password manager, self-hosting, you know what? I think it's important enough to even try like a Bitwarden or RoboForm to get a free account and try it. Okay, now we're coming up to some tips for creating, if you decide to have self-host or not, or if you just decide to have a password manager, what's important is that you come up with a really good, strong password for your password manager. So like the master password. What I recommend is don't use any dictionary words if you can. Come up with some fake words. Go to Google and type in fake word generator and see what comes up. I give you a couple of examples of made up words that you can, you know, you could potentially use them. Just don't use those. I just say that you can come up with any word that you can use and you can combine them two or three together. Make it memorable. It doesn't have to be, it doesn't have to be complicated. Try to make it something, a word that maybe your kid has said that is, you know, it's not a real word, but you like it or something. Make it something, don't make it overcomplicated, because if you do make it overcomplicated, you will forget it and you will lose access to your vault. Now, this is a really, so a password card is a very, very old trip. I actually know somebody that loves those things. Password cards, so essentially what that is that you don't have to come up with any password for yourself. It's essentially each card generates a random sequence of words, letters, and numbers. And all you really have to remember is a line where your password starts and symbols. So for example, you're going to start at sun number 4. So we have 7. So now you have an option. Do you want to go this way, your stuff for your password? Or you want to go this way for your password? And then the beauty of this is you can print a bunch of them. You can have one in your wallet, one in your house, one on your computer. You know what? Nobody will know where do you start? How many characters do you use for your password? How many, things do you use? So this is just like a cheat sheet that I know somebody used. I think they had like 4 copies of it, the one on their desk, one at home, one in their wallet, for their master password, because they didn't want to come up with a word, with a sentence or something, or a phrase. They just wanted to use, random generated password, and they like the idea of having a card, printed card, for your master password. Now, another tip is try to use a phrase or a phrase from a book, your favorite book or a song that you like. Make it, as your master password. That is one password that you have to remember, and that's the one password that you have to make sure it's secure. Either you use a self-hosted password manager or you don't. Now, another tip I can give you is if you do have password manager and you are using Google Authenticator or Microsoft or any app similar to it, they will give some people what they do is they the QR code that you get when you enable that service. Some people like to save it. What I was going to say is don't save that QR code in your password manager. Keep them separate. And the reason for that is if something happens to your password manager, at least if you have an account with 2FA, that is not part of that vault. It's separate. So I actually know somebody that actually prints those QR codes out and does the old-fashioned way and just stores them in their safe at home, just in case they don't want to. If they ever have to move phones or something like that. I know now, recently, Google Authenticator allows us to move our QR codes to a new phone easily, and those QR codes are now stored in the cloud. But this is something something new, something recent that came up with. Now, another recommendation is using a hardware key. If you're going to do it for yourself, I recommend having 2 keys, especially for your main password manager. The reason I say that is that you want to have one that you use with your primary key, and then you want to have another one that's also enrolled as a backup in case you lose your keys or the YubiKey gets destroyed or something, right? I like YubiKeys. They're easy to use. They're not that expensive. I actually have several of them, and those are the ones I picked, but to be honest, there's other ones that you can choose from. And obviously, as we all know, we probably all use Duo. Duo is an application that also gives us that ability, but that's not an option that you have. Some people like Duo, some people don't. It's, to be honest, it's a personal preference which way to go. My personal preference is having a hardware key and either MFA or Duo and Duo service. All right, and that's about it. And the last thing I want to say is that if you are not using a password manager, start using something. The easiest way to entry is using your web browser as your password manager storage. That is essentially your web browser is hosting your passwords. So please use something. Don't use same passwords or many accounts. Just start and do it. That's about it. Thank you for your attention. If anybody has any questions, please let me know.